All right, next thing I want to tackle here is certain coaches having potentially missed their windows. So let's go ahead and talk about this. Have certain coaches missed their windows to get a promotion? I was thinking about this the other day as I watched some guys lose some games, and there are guys either at G5 schools or at P5 schools who are good coaches, I think, who have had some success and ultimately maybe have missed their window to get a promotion. And in some cases, that's fine. Some of these guys have big deals, and they may not be looking for a promotion. But if you go back and think, there's been some guys throughout history who have had really nice starts to their careers at a spot. And you think, okay, that guy is destined to get another job. And then for whatever reason, that fire hose of talent or winning or chemistry, it just shuts off. And it's very difficult to get it back. Let's go ahead and think about one here. Mark Hudspeth, right, who was at Louisiana Lafayette for a long time, was doing a great job. And then it just fell off. And for forever, everybody was like, that guy is going to get a job. And then he just didn't end up getting it because his team didn't stay as good. It's really hard to sustain at that G5 level over and over again, unless you're at one of those schools where you just have tremendous ability to get talent over everybody else, right? Boise, due to its California pipeline, UCF, probably Cincy, schools like that. So let's go ahead and down, and I have my list here, and we're just going to discuss whether they have missed their window or not. I'm not going to say all of these guys have, because I don't really believe that. I think some of these guys probably still have plenty of upward mobility if they get it going. But how about Ken Niumatalolo at Navy? We saw him mull over the BYU job a couple years ago. I think he's a really damn good coach, but Navy has just not been as good so far this year, although they hung a little bit tougher with Houston than Vegas expected, and we were on that one, so I was happy to see that. Last year was a very difficult year for Navy. They had that terrible start with the non-contact COVID practices, and there are so many challenges for a triple option type coach anyway to get a job. I still think that if for some reason BYU needed to hire a coach, that he would be in contention there. But the bloom is off the rose there a little bit. And that's one to kind of think about it. What about Dino Babers? Now, this is kind of obvious, but if you go back to, was it 2017 or 2018? Dino Babers won, I think, 9 or 10 games at Syracuse. He was running the Art Briles offense, but was not connected to the Art Briles scandal, which back then was a huge deal. If you weren't connected to that and you ran that wide open offense that he had also had success with at, I believe, Bowling Green, he was a hot name. And for whatever reason, I think offensive line development has been a major problem there. Babers has not been able to recapture that magic. Now they are, 3-1 this year? I believe they lost to Rutgers. Shout out Lance Glenn, our number one Rutgers fan at 24/7 Sports. But I mean, I think if he had followed up that 1-9-win season with another one, he would be in position to jump. And now it doesn't look like it's likely to happen. Mike Gundy, somebody who was connected to producer Jordan's Tennessee team several times. Like, Oklahoma State is actually off to a really nice start this year, but the way they're winning is not typical Oklahoma State. They have won so far with defense, the offense, in part due to injuries, but also in part due to some quarterback issues, has not looked very good. And we'll have to see. I'm a little bit skeptical that Gundy could still go out there and get like a major SEC job at this point, or a major Big Ten job. Oklahoma State's a good job, and he makes a lot of money there. And I think for the most part, the fans like him. Sometimes he's had some kind of back and forth with the administration. But Mike Gundy is one whose star certainly used to be higher. So we'll see on that. A name that many of you in the comment section have brought up, it was certainly on my list, P.J. Fleck. Man, P.J. Fleck is a guy that I thought maybe could get the Oregon job. A guy who I thought, hey, he hung tough with Ohio State. Maybe if they look good going forward, they did beat the heck out of Colorado. Maybe he'd get a mention for the USC job, although some people think his shtick is kind of fake, and some people really buy in. But the hire of Mike Sanford on offense, I think, is one that has really hurt his career as far as ability to move up. Not a good hire, in my opinion. Offensive efficiency has really dropped off since they lost Kirk Soraka. they lost some important receivers there too. But man, yeah, certainly not somebody I think could go out and get a major job, a major step up for Minnesota right now, given that they just lost as a 31-point favorite to Bowling Green, which is the biggest upset of the year, including these FCS upsets too. I mean, I'm an FSU fan graduate, and they were a 26, 27-point favorite, I think, against Jacksonville State. Bowling Green was an even bigger underdog and went on the road to beat Minnesota. So one that we're going to have to monitor there. I think Fleck is young enough to where if he does get it turned around with the Gophers, it's possible that things could still go his way as far as getting a better job. But certainly that loss hurts his chances quite a bit. Jeff Brohm at Purdue, again, a guy who had very hot as a G5 coach, gets a P5 job. It's on the lower end of P5 jobs. And luckily for him, Purdue locked him up to a big-time contract. So he is making big-time money, but he is not on an upward trajectory. They did beat Illinois barely over the weekend, thanks in part to some really bad punting decisions by Brett Bielema. And, you know, that'll be one to monitor there. But I don't see him getting another big-time job anytime soon unless he does something really special with Purdue. An interesting question would be if Scott Satterfield was to leave Louisville, would Brohm still get a look at Louisville? It's possible. Seth Luttrell, one from North Texas here, is one that I'm interested in. He was really doing well, and ultimately, it's just fallen off. Another good example, if you're a G5 coach, you can bet on yourself. You can turn down job offers. It's possible, right? We are seeing Luke Fickell of Cincinnati do it. I think we're still seeing Billy Napier do it. But man, the odds of you maintaining that success are not great. And Luttrell was a really hot name, an offense that scores a whole lot of points. And since then, their defense has just been an absolute disaster over the last couple of years. And he's not going to be getting any bigger jobs anytime soon. I think Hugh Freeze is an interesting one on this list as well, the Liberty coach. I think we all kind of know why he didn't get bigger jobs recently. Was going to have to go kind of do the rehab camp there at Liberty. But so far this year, Liberty doesn't look very good. They're not scoring a lot of points. Syracuse pretty much shut their offense down. They beat Troy, but did it kind of with defense. And if they're not scoring a whole lot of points, I don't think Freeze is nearly as an attractive coach as he once was. David Shaw is another one on my list here. He's a guy we discussed on the Cover 3 podcast a lot. If you recall, the coach who was the most adamant as far as opposing the early signing period, it was David Shaw. And the reason was because of when Stanford actually offers admission to guys, a lot of times people, like kids, already want to have their decision made up before this new early signing period, before Stanford is even able to really firmly offer them admission. I don't think any program has been hurt more by the early signing period than David Shaw. And then finally, as far as the head coaches, I think Kyle Whittingham is an interesting one. Just cannot seem to get the offense right there at Utah, and the defense this year has been okay, but not necessarily great, right? That's one he was always mentioned for jobs. He would get bandied about on some of these hot boards or hot lists when they were rumored to be firing Clay Helton there at USC. But recent success hasn't totally been there. We will see if Utah gets it turned around more in conference play, but certainly somebody whose stock is a little bit down as far as making that jump, you know, if he even wants to make that jump. Jason Candle, by the way, was another good name. My friend Chris Hummer brought it up today in the 24/7 Sports Slack chat. Toledo guy, maybe will bounce back, but you know, just that's a tough one. It is very hard to sustain long term in the MAC because typically it's do you have a special quarterback? Do you somehow get an NFL guy or two where the defense just can't cover him? You go score a bunch of points, you win. But can you actually sustain it? That's difficult. On the coordinator side, I know a couple of y'all asked about this. Tony Elliott is a name who his stock is certainly down based on this year and this team. But I will say I think Tony Elliott's a very good recruiter. I think he's a smart football coach, and he's a pretty proven football coach. Clemson's going through some stuff right now. I think they'll be back. I don't think Clemson's going to have some huge, sustained, you know, multi-season drop-off. And I actually don't think Tony Elliott's stock is that down. I think Tony Elliott is picky for a reason and can afford to be so.